Well, do turn in your Bibles to Psalm 23. If you're using the Bible in the rack in front of you, you can find it on page 458. I'll be reading all six verses this morning from Psalm 23. Hear now the reading of God's holy word. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. And surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. A friend of mine recently emailed me a humorous story about a Sunday school teacher who had decided to have her young class memorize a chapter of Scripture. She had chosen Psalm 23 and gave the children about a month to learn the chapter. Little Tommy was very excited about the task. The only problem is that he couldn't remember the psalm. And after much practice, he could barely get through the first line. Well, we all know the day arrived when the children were to recite their chapter, and everyone stepped up to the microphone one by one. Well, it was little Tommy's turn, and he was exceedingly nervous, but he stepped up to the microphone and said proudly, "The Lord is my shepherd, and that's all I need to know." Well, there's a lot of truth to Tommy's little words. And friends, wherever you find yourself today, if you are in Christ, He is your good shepherd. And what you and I need more than anything is to know Him and to trust in Him. Whether you are in a summery season of green pastures and still waters, or you find yourself in the valley of the shadow of death. A couple of weeks ago, I was listening to a sermon by Dr. Boyce. The sermon is dated in 1998. And in it, he said that the evangelical church in America no longer wrestles with the issue of inerrancy and the infallibility of Scripture, meaning that there is no longer a wholesale debate about whether all of Scripture is God's word written down. Now, that is still true to today. Jesus says in John chapter 17, "Your word is truth." Now, the issue that we wrestle with today, as Dr. Boyce actually went on with, it is true not only in 1988, it is still true today, and that concerns the sufficiency of Scripture. We are unsure of whether Scripture in fact is enough for us. We struggle to take God at His word. We wonder if God will actually do for me what He says He will do, whether He will shepherd me in the valley of the shadow of death, or whether or not He will in fact provide for me in the wilderness period where water is scarce and times of testing are many, or whether He will hear the cry of your soul when you say, "Restore me, O God." What Dr. Boyce was getting at is that all too frequently we see an unhealthy bifurcation between what we affirm theologically with our heads and what we practice in our lives. Following Jesus involves obeying Him, heeding His word, We see in the Great Commission in Matthew 28, as Jesus commissions his disciples, he says to them, "And teaching them to follow all that I've commanded you." Now, in the Westminster Larger Catechism, is very helpful on this topic of looking at Scripture and man. It says that the Scriptures principally teach what man is to believe concerning God, faith, and what duty, obedience, God requires of man. In other words, the Scriptures are the only rule of faith and obedience for the church. Friends, this is God's Word. God's Word is true. And God's Word is sufficient for you and for me, for us who are in Christ. James, the brother of Jesus, talks in the opening chapter of his epistle of two men. Both of those men heard the word of God spoken and preached. The one heard the word preached and went away obeying it. He put it into practice. And he was blessed by the word of God. The other heard the very same word, but he did not obey God's word. That same word did not bless him, but rather he was deceived by that same word. To one it is life-giving, and to the other it hardens the heart. And so James exhorts us, in terms of the sufficiency of Scripture, he exhorts us to three things. Those three things are: one, be quick to hear the word. Two, receive the word with meekness. And three, apply it with perseverance. And this word will be life to your soul. Today's sermon is the third in a three-part sermon series. We first had a look at "The Lord is my shepherd king," David's words as he speaks about the wonder of his great God, the covenant God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Our second part in the sermon series considered the implications thereof. If the Lord is my shepherd, David says, the result thereof is that I will lack for nothing. I shall not want. A little later on, he goes on to say also is that I will fear no evil. Now remember, this is not some utopian idealism that David is concerning himself with. David is very much speaking about and writing about his relationship with himself and the shepherd, a sheep with a shepherd, and concerning the various seasons of the soul, the earthly realities of our day-to-day existence. Friends, God knows our frame. He knows that we are but dust, and to dust we shall return, that we grow tired, we become weary, at times are even lonely, and even become depressed. Our good shepherd, who is also our faithful high priest, sympathizes with us in our weakness. He cares for us. Today, we turn our attention to the final two verses in this text, in Psalm 23 and verse 5 and 6 of this majestic psalm, and our study yields three main points for us. First, God prepares a table for the people of God amidst their enemies. Secondly, David concerns or writes about that which we pursue and that which pursues us, that which we follow and that which follows after us. And then thirdly, he talks about making it all the way home to dwell with God all our days, forever. Last sermon in this series, we saw the protection of the Lord in the valley of the shadow of death. That was verse 4. In verse 5, the enemies of God have not departed. They are there, but there is a change with respect to emphases. It's very positive in the sense of that even in the midst of our enemies, God provides for us. Not only does he protect us with his rod and his staff, but he provides for his people. Now in verse 5, there is a small division amongst commentators concerning how we are to understand verse 5. What I mean here is that when we talk about, when David writes, "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies," many see a transition of metaphors. What I mean by that is the first four verses of the psalm is very clearly a metaphor about a shepherd. The Lord, the covenant-keeping God, is a shepherd. But in verse 5, some see that a transition of metaphor from shepherd to a host, even a kingly host. Now, on the other hand, Philip Keller, for one, argues that the entirety of the psalm, all six verses, are to be read through the lens of, as a metaphor of God as shepherd, shepherd king. Now, as a minister of the gospel, Philip Shepherd, who prior to him being a minister of the gospel, was in fact a shepherd of physical sheep that shepherded them in fields and did so for 8 years, he writes interestingly as follows. He sees at least the preparation of the table in the presence of our enemies as referring to how a shepherd would go ahead of his sheep. And he would prepare a grazing area up on the flat mountain top, checking for poisonous weeds, strategically placing various minerals and salt for the sheep as they would come and graze. Now, these flat mountain tops are commonly called mesas or mountain lands. In fact, the city of my birth in Cape Town, South Africa, is famously known for Table Mountain. And these mesas or tablelands are found in many parts of the world, here at home, in our country, as well as in Israel. And so in the midst of a sheep's predators, their enemies, a shepherd would prepare the tableland, for his sheep to safely graze upon. Now David goes on in verse 5 to say that you anoint my head with oil. He is not speaking here about the anointing of a king, but rather he is talking about bathing the head with oil. Now, in ancient Near East hospitality, a host would pour oil with sweet-smelling essences upon a guest's head, upon their hair and on their face prior to the meal. And it would refresh the skin after the guest had walked in harsh and dry conditions. And the guest's cup was lavishly overflowed so as to quench his thirst from such a journey, as well as to lavishly bless him. In fact, we read in Psalm 104 of bringing wine to gladden the heart of man, oil to make his face shine, and bread to strengthen man's heart. You see, part of the host's duty in those times was to protect the guest from their enemies as they dined together at the table. Now, Philip Keller, who has this singular understanding, as well as others, of a shepherd in Psalm 23, says that since summertime for a shepherd is in fact called fly time, a shepherd applies a mixture of linseed oil, of sulfur, as well as tar, all over the sheep's head to cure the sheep of a variety of serious fly ailments. Not only does this oil-based mixture have medicinal properties, but when it's applied to the sheep's head, it keeps the flies away. And almost instantaneously, the sheep that is rather uncomfortable about the flies is calmed when it's applied to its head. Now, one thing is undeniable about verse 5 as we look here is we see the provision and care of God for his sheep, for his own, even when their enemies surround them. Not only is God active in the protection of those who are his own, but he provides for them. We don't need to fear, friends, the evil that may arise, not because we are strong, but because of who he is. Because he is our shepherd rather than we ourselves being our own strength and tower. But our God is the one who stands for us. And we can rest assured that God will provide for us, even in the midst of our enemies. Now, friends, this language of enemies is not foreign to the gospel. We see that Jesus had many enemies, those who stood against him, ultimately those who pinned him to the cross. And in fact, believers have enemies just like our Savior. As we walk in his footsteps, as we are those who reflect our Savior, Jesus says that we too will have enemies. We see this in the Sermon on the Mount. We see in Luke chapter 6, as Luke in his account of the gospel elaborates, and I read, he says, "Love your enemies. Do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. And to one who strikes you on the cheek," which means to the one who insults you, "offer the other also. And from one who takes away your cloak, do not withhold your tunic either. Give to everyone who begs from you, and from one who takes away your goods, do not demand them back. And as you wish that others would do to you, do so to them." Jesus continues on. He says, "If you love those who love you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who do good to you, what benefit is that to you? For even sinners do the same. And if you lend to those from whom you expect to receive, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great, and you will be sons of the Most High. For he is kind to the ungrateful and to the evil. Be merciful, even as your Father is merciful." How remarkable is this teaching of Christ? How impossible is this teaching without the Spirit of the living God? God goes ahead of each one of us, prepares a table in the presence of our enemies. It is only because of Christ that we can respond as he exhorts us in Luke 6, not because you or I am strong, but because his grace is sufficient. Because he knows from the beginning to the end, because he is our great and our good, our perfect Shepherd King. The Word of God, brothers and sisters, is enough for you and for me. In truth, those who lie about you, who falsely accuse you, who look for ways to undermine you, even destroy you, they sin against you. And those who persecute you for your faith do not hate you so much as they, in fact, hate Christ, our God. Yet Jesus doesn't say an eye for an eye. Rather, he says, do good to those who hate you. Bless those who curse you. Pray for those who abuse you. And here he's talking about abuse in the most broadest sense. Turn the other cheek to the one who insults you. And we may ask the question, why? Because the Most High is kind to the ungrateful and to the evil. That means that the one who is over us, the one who is over all things, the one who is called Most High, possessor of the heavens and the earth, he is kind. In the New Testament, we read of the kindness of God. God is long-suffering. He is patient, longing for those who are in sin to repent. And he has been kind to me, a sinner, a wretch, such that I humbly bow and sing, Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. And my God, who holds me and all things, is kind to the ungrateful and to the evil. We do not repay evil for evil, but are merciful, just as our Father in heaven is merciful. When you are sinned against, do not let that sin, their sin, cause you or I to sin. This doesn't mean that we are not to be wise in times like that, or never to flee from abusive situations, nor to cry out to the living God for justice to prevail when wickedness seems to win the day. Each one of us stands before God, before a holy God, but let us leave room for God to act, for God to be the Shepherd King, for the justice of God to arise. Let us leave room for the mercy of God to triumph and for God to sustain the righteous even in the presence of our enemies. Remember, brothers and sisters, that the Good Shepherd is not a hired hand. He leaves the sheep. That's what the hired hand does. At the first sight of danger, the hired hand leaves. He's gone because the sheep are not his own. He doesn't protect his own, but rather runs. Our Savior is not like that. Rather, he lays down his life for his own. We are to be imitators, called to follow him, to be like Christ, who loves the unlovely, who died for his enemies, who heard the mocking jeers and false accusations when he was on the cross, and yet he was silent. How marvelous are the opening words of Paul the common introduction as he writes to the various churches. And in his epistles, he says time and time again, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. To the weary, grace to you and peace. To the downcast, grace and peace to you in Christ. David goes on to write in verse 6, which transitions to our second point tonight, this morning, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. Now, in the Hebrew, what's interesting is that we can translate that verse as follows: only goodness and steadfast love shall follow me all the days of my life. Again, what a most remarkable statement. And you may be tempted to say that David has taken some kind of poetic license, or he has embellished the truth with some ornate language. But before we are tempted to doubt the sufficiency of God's word in this respect, let us have a little look at what it is that is going on here. Remember, David is relating himself as a sheep to his perfect shepherd king, God. The very nature of a sheep is to follow the voice of a shepherd. In other words, the shepherd is to be a sheep's guide, their protector, their provider, their all in all. Sheep follow a shepherd. They obey the shepherd's voice rather than another's. And this gets to the very heart of our desires. A Christian is someone who has been made alive by the Spirit of God. We have been born again from above, regenerated. We were dead in our sins, in our transgressions, and the Spirit of God breathed the resurrection life of God into us. We were quickened by the call of God. And so nothing satisfies the depths of our soul like the living God. Nothing satisfies the depths of our soul. And so our souls are stirred, our hearts are stirred when we read a text like Psalm 42. As the deer pants for flowing streams, so pants my soul for you, O God. And if that's not where you are this morning, as a present reality in your life, the heart of a believer so longs to say, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. You may have heard of the comic strip Arlo and Janice. Janice is Arlo's wife. Well, one night, Arlo and Janice are outside in the snow. They're enjoying a beautiful evening as they gaze up into the heavens, into the sky, and see the beautiful stars. Arlo says to Janice, it's so quiet. Yes, she says. And as they walk into the night, Arlo says, have you ever noticed that the best moments make you feel insignificant? Friends, nobody visits the Grand Canyon with the goal of making themselves look great. We are awed by the vastness and the beauty of nature. You see, written deep on the soul of men and women's hearts is the truth that we were made to make much of God. And contrary to many of our American axioms is that we find our ultimate joy not in being significant, but in finding, in knowing the infinitely significant one. That is what fills our hearts, and out of them flows rivers of living water to magnify the name of our wonderful Savior. In today's world, men and women are all too often running to and fro, running after goodness and mercy. They are trying to find two things: freedom and happiness. But such a pursuit, as Solomon once said, is vanity, striving after the wind. And the marvel of the gospel is this, that in seeking goodness and mercy in our own effort, the depths of our soul will not be satisfied, and goodness and mercy will elude us. And yet, when we heed the call of the Good Shepherd, you will gain Christ and be satisfied in him. In turn, David says, goodness and steadfast love will pursue you. And Jesus says, come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. What a marvelous, marvelous Savior. You see, at the heart of this magnificent psalm is the trust of a man in his God. He is a sheep who follows the most perfect shepherd king. And because of who his shepherd is, he will lack for nothing. He is to heed the words, the commands of his shepherd, who calls him unto himself and who instructs him in following him in the paths of righteousness. And in so doing, goodness, the goodness of God, will follow you when enemies press in around you. Now, in the scriptures, we find that the steadfast love of God is without comparison. There is nothing like the steadfast love of God, the covenant love of God, the mercy of God towards his people. No amount of money, of fame, of possessions can compare to the steadfast love of the Lord. If God is with you, what can compare to that? And when times of great difficulty arise, God is at work. He is not silent. He is not absent. And though we may not see the invisible God, our great God, with the naked eye, our God is faithful to his covenant. Covenant with Abraham and his descendants, of whom we who are in Christ are a part. And so, brothers and sisters, trust in the Lord and do good. Fear him rather than man. Listen to the author of Hebrews in Hebrews chapter 13 in verse 5 and 6. For God has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper, I will not fear. What can man do to me? There's no arrogance in that statement, because the statement doesn't rest on the strength of you and I, but it is the Lord who is my helper, who is my shepherd king, who is my protector, my guide, and my provider. The psalmist in Psalm 31 says, blessed be the Lord, For he has wondrously shown his steadfast love to me when I was in a besieged city. How wonderful. As I bring this to a close this morning, our third point is we see David writes, he says, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. One thing that's important for us to note is the movement that we find in Psalm 23. The movement really is along the lines of a very long journey of a shepherd with his sheep. And first, the sheep is made to lie down in green pastures. They were then led beside still waters into a path of righteousness and up the valley of the shadow of death, up onto the tableland, the mesa, where the table, the shepherd would prepare a place for the sheep, and then would return home, all the way home, to dwell, sheep and shepherd, all their days, forever. This, friends, is the goal of salvation. That which has begun will be brought to completion. For us who are in Christ, we have tasted of the powers of the age to come. We have been satisfied in our souls with the deepest or the richest of fear. Yet we long for more. And today, we are being shepherded, little by little, shepherded home. This brings great assurance, the assurance of salvation to us. What a marvelous, marvelous shepherd king. And one day, in an instant, at the consummation of the ages, we shall be changed. This mortal and fading body will put on immortality. Death will be no more, and all things will be made right. No longer will there be corruption of sin, whether our sin or being sinned against. You see, that which was first begun in the Garden of Eden will be completed in that great heavenly city, the New Jerusalem. God dwelling with man, the shepherd dining with his own at the wedding feast of the Lamb. And until that great day, the shepherd king calls us to himself. He leads us out of the bondage of sin through the wilderness trials until that great day when we will dwell with God in his house forever, not because of how good we are or how strong we might be, but because of who he is and who he is alone. Day and night, that good shepherd, our high priest, intercedes for you, and his power is made perfect in our weakness. His power is made perfect in our weakness. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we hope for what we do not see. We wait for it with patience, knowing that the Spirit helps us in our weakness and that our Shepherd King is good, providing for us amidst our enemies. And may the words of our heart echo the psalmist who writes, "Let me hear in the morning of your steadfast love, for in you I trust." We ask this in the matchless name of our great Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.